Hello folks, welcome back to the Litpedia world, and I am Abhinay Gupta, and we are continuing with the topic, the winding up. Considering the provisions of the Companies Act 1956 instead of Companies Act 2013, right? So in the previous lecture, we were discussing about the concept of winding up by the court, right? We have already gone into a detailed discussion between rationalizing the winding up by the court. Whether it should, whether it should not, what are the circumstances, what are the consequences, right? So basically, what did we see in that class, in that lecture, is that winding up by the court, right, is a discretionary power which is given to the court, right? That is the first thing. Next, the conditions or the grounds of compulsory winding up that we have seen in section 433, those grounds are not a matter of right, right? Because that is why the court is involved, so that the court would take a just and equitable decision, a rational decision, right? So what are the factors that we have seen that should be considered by the court? Any of the ground individually will not force the court to wind up, right? So when the court goes on to see the rational decision, right, what will it see? It will see the interest of the society. It could see the interest of justice. Law of prudence will be applied, right? The court will investigate into the matter and understand the cause behind such failure for the company. If the company is not able to pay the loan, not able to pay the creditors, right? If it did not suspend, if it suspended the business for 1 year or did not commence the business for 1 year, whatever be the ground, any other fixed ground, any other just and equitable ground if you talk about, right? The court will not on the face look at the petition and pass an order. There will be a case, there will be a hearing, right? So there are basically very many matters, very many factors that the court needs to consider before awarding winding up, before ordering winding up. That is, who is gaining out of it? The petitioner, is the petitioner actually gaining in the cognate sense? And if he's gaining, who is losing on the other end? The employees are losing, the market, the society, the public in general, the economy, the government, the creditors, they're losing the business. There are a lot many people who are losing again. Right? Even if we do not consider about the company, but then we consider about the bank who has given the loan and the people on the other end. Is the loss of bank worth the loss of the other people? Any one of you have to lose. Either the bank loses the money for some time and then there is a possibility of it getting back, or the other people lose everything. So the court needs to consider that. Right? So we talked about all of those things. We talked about what are the cases that the bank will that the court will consider before closing down the company. That yeah, there will be a business that is coming to an end, a business that is into manufacturing, a business that is into service providing, or whatever it is. The product is going out of market. People are thrown out of employment. Government is losing their tax revenue out of custom, excise, sales tax, income tax, whatever it is. The scarcity of good and diminishing of the employment opportunities in the market. These factors needs to be considered by the court before it orders winding up. Right? So for this, we have a question that was asked in CA Final November 2002. So below are the points of the question, the content of the question, and based on that, we need to decide on our answer. So as per the question, the company XYZ Limited has taken a loan of 2 crore from a bank. Right? It has entered into all the agreements and stuff. It has given a security. It has taken a loan. Then the company was not able to pay the installment as it was required, right, by the loan agreement that the bank had, that the company had entered into with the bank. So what did the bank do? The bank filed a petition with the High Court on the ground that the company is unable to pay the debt. Now the company has to defend. So the company opposes the petition for winding up on the ground that it has employed 1,000 workers and paid their salaries regularly, and that it has paid the government taxes and all the dues to the government on a regular basis. The company has further contended that if the company is compelled to repay the loan immediately, it will cripple the company, causing hardship on the employee and the other person having business dealings with the company. And the company for this is also supported by the major creditors. Now, you are required to explain the circumstance under which the company may be ordered to be wound up by the court on the ground of inability to pay debt and whether the bank will succeed in the case. That means whether the company will actually order winding up. So what do you think? If you look into the matter, if you understand, if you relate to the case, what do you think? What are the things happening over here? First thing is the company has taken loan. Okay, 2 crore, big amount. Where has it failed? As per the loan agreement, it failed in certain installments. Right? The court, what should the bank do basically? The bank should have reached the court that they are not able to pay my debt. Arrange my debt back. I want it. Compel the company, send them notice to repay my debt. Sell off any asset and repay my debt. Whatever you do, repay the debt. But what does the court do? The bank goes to the court and says, I want winding up. I don't know for what sake, first of all. Right? Then what happened is the company goes on to defend. I am a big company. I have 1,000 workers. You imagine 1,000 workers, that means it's a huge company. And if the company is able to pay their salaries and the government taxes on a regular basis, that means the company is operating very well. It is just a temporary cash crisis. And if the company is given time, they would come out of it, out of that crisis, and pay off the loan. Because if 1,000 workers have not been retrenched, if they are still on employment and if they are still working, that means the company has demand in the market. The operations are running. So the turnovers will be high and they will get the money. Right? And the company also sees that, yes, if I am compelled by the court, then I would be crippled. Because if I give them my money to the court, I will not be able to pay off the workers or the government taxes, or I will not be able to expand my business. That will be the hardship on the employees as well. And all the people who are making business with me. And the good thing is even the creditors who may not be getting the money or who may be getting the money, whatever be the case, even they are in support of the company. So now how do you proceed with your answers basically? You remember the pattern of how we write the answer. First you write the provisions of the given of the section. Then you write the content, what the question asks, and then the conclusion. So what is the section that you would refer to? You would refer to section 433 first. That the winding up by the court, that procedure basically begins on the 6 grounds of winding up, which is contained under 433 A to F. Right? That is the first thing you'll mention. And over there, you will have to mention about this debt factor. The 433E provides that the company would be wound up if it is unable to pay its debt. And under section 434, a company shall be deemed to be unable to pay the debt because of the following circumstances. Then you go on to jot the circumstance. That, yeah, if it fails to pay the debt exceeding rupees 500, and that too for more than 3 weeks, that means if the creditors have given their notice in writing to the registered office, the company has received it. Still for the next 3 weeks, the company is not paying and the amount is more than 500, it will be wound up. Right? And when the company fails to satisfy the court decree in favor of the creditor, whether whole or in part, or when it is proved that the company is unable to pay the debt. And whenever we get a question on the winding up on this part of the syllabus, always remember the case study that we have discussed. Just remember the name quoted over here. It has all the cases involved. Tata Iron and Steel Company versus Micro Forge India Limited. That's it. Right? Don't get into the detail as to what was the case. Just remember that if you have a question on this reference, specifically the employee part, give a reference to that case study. Right? Then you will go on that, yeah, there are these grounds, but it is not obligatory to the court. It is the discretionary power of the court. When you write that, yes, the court will decide whether or not to order winding up, it will consider the interest of justice, the interest of the society, right? The law of prudence, all these words you'll use over there. And then at the end, you'll say that the court would take into consideration the entire status and position of the company in the market. And what are the factors it would consider? Whether it would mean to the loss of employment to the employees over here? Yes. It would also result in diminishing employment opportunity if the company is wound up. Right? Since we see in the question, they are regular at paying salaries and also the taxes. So even the government will be losing on the revenue part. Whatever source it is coming from, it is losing the revenue. Right? Since you again see that the creditors are also in favor of the company, that means even the creditors will be losing a lot of business over here and they don't want the company to be wound up. Right? And then you write that there seems to be a temporary cash crisis. Why? Because they are regular still with their salaries and their taxes. It's a temporary cash crisis. Give them some time to come out of it. There's no big deal with that. Right? And then at the end you say that the company is an ongoing concern and ordering winding up will actually result in putting an end to the entire functioning of the company. Putting an end to the entrepreneurship, putting an end to the business. Right? Bringing several employees out of their job, unemployed. It will be hardship on the family, hardship on the creditors and everything. And then you conclude that the court should not be ordering winding up. It is as simple as that. So basically now you understand the winding up by the court, the entire concept of how it goes. Right? So that will be all for this lecture also. In the next lecture, we'll continue with the petition for compulsory winding up, section 439. Right? So until then, this is Abhinay Gupta signing off. Thank you. Bye-bye.